Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J traveled to Grand Rapids to participate in Acton University, a four-day exploration of the intellectual foundations of a free society, attended by over 1,000 participants from around the world. She gave two talks. This is the first breakout session, The Family and the Market. Stay tuned for her second one.
And it's 9 o'clock Acton Standard Time. So we're all set to go here. Yes, so among the books we'll be raffling off is this one called 101 Tips for a Happier Marriage, which I'll allude to at some point in this. And then also a book written by one of our Ruth Institute students named Alana Newman. It's called Anonymous Us. She is herself a donor-conceived person, and she started the Anonymous Us Story Collective, where people can go and write and talk about their stories of what it was like for them to find out that their dad was purchased through a vial of sperm that came via UPS or whatever. You know, whatever their stories are, they have some pretty difficult stories in some cases, right? So the Anonymous, this is a compilation of things that have been written by people who were in some way affected by donor conception, either the donor-conceived persons, in some cases people who were sperm donors, surrogate mothers, all that kind of thing. She's allowing people to talk about what that was like for them because it's such a, you know, it needs to be talked about. But the point is, we'll be raffling these books off later today, toward the end of the day. And I do have one other talk that I'll be giving this afternoon at 3:45. So this talk is called The Family and the Market. The second talk will be The Family and the State. Okay, and so part of what we're trying to accomplish in these two talks is to deal with the fact that we often, in economics, get the idea that there's just the government and there's the state. Or there's the government and the state on one side, and then there's the market and freedom on the other side. And what we need to establish is the fact that there's a whole other realm of human endeavor that we can think of as the social sector that is not strictly private in the way that we think of markets and private property. It's not strictly private, but it certainly isn't government, right? And so there's a whole realm of human endeavor that we haven't paid enough attention to, and prime amongst the institutions of the social sector, of course, would be the family. And so that's what we're going to be working on, is that is to try to break down that strict dichotomy between the family, between the state and the market. Let me just stay by way of introduction. The organization that I founded, in part modeled on the Acton Institute, the Ruth Institute, we have a dream at the Ruth Institute. Our dream is that every child will be welcomed into a loving home with a married mother and father. That's our dream. And our vision of how that's going to happen is that we're going to reach out to the survivors of the sexual revolution, and they are going to change the narrative. They're going to change the social story around sex, marriage, and family. And those survivors are going to be the ones who are going to create a climate favorable to lifelong married love. We came up with this because I finally figured out I can't do this by myself, see? So we had to recruit the survivors. And the survivors include people like adult children of divorce, reluctantly divorced people, heartbroken career women who have it all but don't have any children, people who have in one way or another been harmed by the sexual revolution. That's who we're talking about, is the survivors. And the survivors are resolute, courageous, and fun-loving people. We're not sitting around, you know, whining, right? But, and we're reaching out to help the young, to help the next generation, to let people learn something from these experiences. And so our mission, the mission of the Ruth Institute, is to inspire the survivors of the sexual revolution to recover from their negative experiences and to share their stories with the young. So this particular session, We're going to be addressing three questions. And these three questions are, in a sense, what I'm going to do is to present to you a lot of the material that I would normally present when people, you know, ask me, Dr. Morse, come and talk to us about the family. I'm going to present a lot of that material, but with a unique Acton flavor to it, a unique Acton spin to it. And one of the key things that I want you guys to walk out of here with are things that you can say to your libertarian friends who don't get it. Okay, do any of you have libertarian friends who agree with you about the free market? You know, you're kind of all on the same page about the market and so on, but you can't get them to take the family seriously, okay? So I've given those people a lot of thought since I used to be such a person, so the questions are kind of redefined to help that group of people. So first of all, we want to ask some questions that would be important to libertarians. Is the family part of the market or part of the state? And I'm going to show you that the answer is really neither, right? And so we have to give you some tools for talking to people about that. What does the family do that the market and the state both need? This is going to be the heart of the talk, the thing I'll spend a lot of time on, what the family actually does. And then finally, does the destruction of the family, or I should say, how does the destruction of the family undermine the whole program of trying to create a free society of free and responsible individuals and limited constitutional government? Because all your libertarian friends care about a free society, a free and responsible individuals, constitutionally limited government. What I want to say to you basically can be summarized by saying, no family, no freedom. If you don't get the family right, you are not going to have a free society. Okay? So, a lot of the same material that I might give if you were to invite me to come and talk to your church group, if you were to invite me to come and do a seminar for all the priests of your diocese, which I have done many times, by the way, many dioceses, many seminaries I've been to. We just did a program in Dallas-Fort Worth at the Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary, talking to their faculty and students and so on, you know, about some of these issues. Same type of stuff, but here we want to pay particular attention to those libertarian fiscal conservative friends that you might have who you want to bring on board with some of these family issues. So that's why we've just redone some of this material. Okay, so is the family part of the market or a part of the state? And by the way, this is the way I do my outline. This is the outline of what we're going to talk about, these three questions. The beginning of each session will just simply highlight the thing we're going to talk about. So first, we're going to talk about, is the family part of the market or part of the state? Now, the first thing to say about the family under this heading is to understand that we have to think about the family as something on its own. Okay? I think it's safe to say that most modern philosophers, most modern thinkers, do not see the family as its own institution with its own integrity, its own needs, its own purpose. They either want to redefine the family as something political, or they want to redefine the family as something economic, right? So a lot of political philosophers, if you read through what the modern political philosophers have had to say, they totally don't get the family. So there's a book out there called The Family in Politics, and it's by a philosophy professor named Scott Yenner. What he does is he goes through all of the major modern political philosophers, starting with Locke and Hobbes and Jean-Jacques Rousseau and Hegel and John Stuart Mill, all these people, you know, since the Enlightenment, and he says, well, what do they have to say about the family? What do they have to say about marriage? And the answer he comes up with is basically none of them has a clue. Not one of them has a stinking clue what the family is all about. And if you read through it, what you'll find the modern philosophers doing is using the family as a vehicle somehow for explaining their political philosophy. You know, so in other words, what they really care about are the political arrangements, and somehow they'll use the family as a foil for explaining that, or the family will somehow reveal something about political arrangements. But as to the family itself, they haven't got a clue what it's all about. And the way you can tell that is that they never talk about children. Or when they do talk about children, they don't know what they're talking about. I mean, literally, they don't know what they're talking about. So that whole primary business of the family, the thing that the family does, which propels the society forward, it's like somehow that's going to happen by a miracle. You know, I mean, they don't get what that's about. So on the philosophical, political side, that's what we're dealing with. And And one of the problems with that is that when we go to think about it, we don't have a framework for thinking about it, right? So we have these words now that we're all worried about, equality. Anybody heard people talk about marriage equality? People talk about equality between men and women, right? Equality is a political concept. It doesn't belong in the family, right? You need different concepts that have to do with justice or fairness or people treating one another with dignity and so on. Equality doesn't work inside the family. So we're importing politics into the family where it doesn't belong. And then secondly, the other thing that we have a tendency to do is to think in terms, is to redefine marriage or the family as a series of contracts. Okay, and economists are particularly guilty of this. One of our famous economists named Gary Becker he won the Nobel Prize in economics basically for saying that the family could be understood as an economic system. And he wrote all this stuff on the economics of the family. And so what that did was to give people a framework for thinking about the family. And people thought, oh, this is great, you know, now we know what to think about. But the problem is it's incomplete. The problem is it didn't make any sense. So we have a template now in our culture for understanding why adults want children. Gary Becker taught us to understand why adults want children. Adults want to receive a stream of child services. I'm not making this up. They want to receive a stream of child services from the child. And so it's an investment decision to decide whether to have a child, when to have the child, and so on. And since the child delivers a stream of services over a long period of time, it's an investment. And so the purchase of a child or the acquisition of a child can be compared to the purchase of a consumer durable, such as a refrigerator or a car. Okay? That's the economic analysis of children. So that allows us to have a template, as I say, for understanding why an adult would want a child. It's a commodity. Okay? And so, we get that. But what we don't understand is why would a child ever want a parent? What does the child want in the parent relationship? And this is an important issue because of this whole issue of third-party reproduction. In third-party reproduction, adults are buying children. That's what it's about. And they want a child that looks like themselves, and they don't have a relationship with another person, and so one way or the other, they purchase a gamete from somebody else. And so the world is all like, oh, that's nice. It's a market. We understand how markets work. This is great. The adults are getting what they want. But we don't understand why the child cares who their parent actually is. We can't understand why these kids are going around going, I don't like it that I never knew my dad. I want to know why I have freckles and no one else in my house has freckles. I want to meet those people. You know, we have no template at all for seeing what the child has lost by not knowing one of their parents. And that's the price we're paying for having no theory, accurate theory, about the family that stands on its own and is not derivative from either politics or economics. Okay? So you start thinking like that, then you see that this project is actually quite important. So let's talk a little bit about social institutions in a general way. A social institution is more than a collection of individuals. This is the key thing. In this room right now, we're a collection of individuals. It's nice to meet you and everything, but we're all going to go our separate ways. A social institution provides genuine team production where the identity of the other team players might matter. And the product of the social institution can't be privatized easily, can't be distributed easily without significant losses. So you could think about the Grand Rapids Symphony Orchestra as being a kind of social institution. They can't do much individually. It's not just a collection of individuals. There's something they're making together that's bigger and has an identity beyond those particular individuals. And social institutions can have a legal identity that is independent of the individuals as part of it. So the Grand Rapids Symphony Orchestra is a legal thing. When you join the orchestra, you don't lose your personal identity, right? But you are now part of something bigger. Likewise, with the family meets all of these criteria for being a social institution. The production of children is a genuine team effort. I think we would all agree. One man, one woman. It's pretty basic team production, actually. Right? It's the most basic unit of social cooperation you can think of. One man, one woman, you produce the baby. You can't privatize that. Divorce attorneys have been trying for 40 years to somehow divide the product, and it doesn't work. We know for sure it doesn't work to try to do that. And men and women come together spontaneously, organically. They don't usually need any coaxing. Men and women usually get this figured out on their own. Marriage as an institution predates the state. It wasn't created by the state in spite of the state's pretensions these days. It actually predates the state by quite a little bit, you might say. And it solves human problems in a more humane and more personal way than you would ordinarily imagine some kind of bureaucratic thing doing, okay? And also, importantly, from the previous slide, it's important to see that marriage, that the marriage can and should have its own legal identity, separate from the individuals. So that just like when you join the Grand Rapids Symphony Orchestra, you become part of something that has a legal identity, but you don't lose your personal identity. Just so when you get married, there is a thing that you're now part of that should have its own legal identity that's more than just the collection of the individuals, but you don't lose your personal identity as you do it. And one of the things that's happened to us culturally is because of individualism, the whole ideology, well-worked-out ideology of individualism that came about for some very good reasons, some very legitimate reasons, we have broken down the family into a mere collection of individuals. Okay? And so therefore, a lot of the things a family should be doing, could be doing, that nobody else can do, aren't getting done. Okay, and so to understand the marriage as a social institution is a very helpful intellectual construct, and you need to pull that out when you're talking to your libertarian friends, that without a rich collection of social institutions throughout the society, their whole project of minimal government is not going to be able to do very well, because you need families doing this stuff, okay? Now, I always like to point out Pope Leo XIII and his great social encyclical called Rerum Novarum, which was written in 1891. This is really considered the first encyclical of Catholic social teaching. And of Rerum Novarum means of new things. And this was his attempt to deal with the Industrial Revolution. It was his attempt to combat socialism. Right, and to, so that the church would have something to say about the problems of the new things having to do with industrialization and so on, that the church would have something to say that would not be socialism, right? And that would be have a Christian take on what was going on. And so if you read Rerum Novarum, all the way through is a theme that the state does not have the right to take over the institutions of society. In particular, the family has pride of place in this encyclical. A lot of times people read it as an economics encyclical, and it is that in part, but it's much more than that. So those of you who have read it, you know, I would suggest you look at it again through this lens of social institutions and realize that he's saying that the family has rights that the state may not take over. And he's quite adamant about that, as opposed to, you know, some of the other social institutions in society. So the short answer to our opening question, is the family part of the market or part of the state? The short answer is no, neither. It's not part of either of those things. We have to understand the family on its own terms, that it's something that exists on its own terms, it has its own integrity, and we should not be trying to reinterpret it as a special case of either politics or economics, that we're just going to miss it if we do that. You can tell your libertarian friends, though, that like the market, the family is a system of social cooperation. Like the market. But the family is a much more basic system of social cooperation. Mom and dad working together doesn't get much more basic than that, right? And completely without the state. It never, you know, until we had a modern state, you know, like 200-300 years ago, the family was doing okay even without it, you know. So that's important for them to know. So the next batch of questions that we want to talk about is, what does the family do that the rest of society needs? What the market needs it to be done, the state needs it to be done, and I always like to start with this this little cartoon. I don't know if you've ever seen this cartoon before. The question is, how do libertarians deal with the hard problem of children? I know this because I used to give little talks on introduction to libertarianism, and every once in a while somebody would say, you know, I explained non-aggression principle and, you know, all of those things that we talk about under the libertarian aegis, and people would say, well, what about children? And I would say, well, That's a hard question. We'll cover that in a later lesson. And, of course, the later lesson never came. Then I saw this cartoon and realized this is true. Our idea, the libertarian idea, is then a miracle occurs. People are born as babies. Somehow they become 18 years old. They have citizenship papers and a bank account, and they're ready to go. And what happens between birth and that period of time, no one knows. You know, so we got to fill in the blanks here a little bit. And I mean, babies are miraculous, and it is kind of miraculous that any of them survive their teenage years. But that's not what we mean here. So, what a free society really needs is people who can control themselves. See, when we talk about the free society and rational economic man and so on, rational economic man is a very complex character. This is a person who can control himself, who can use his freedom without bothering other people too much, right? Who will keep his contracts, who will not violate the property rights of other people. And I don't know if you've ever noticed this, but 2-year-olds do not respect property rights. Have you ever noticed that? You know, they don't do that, right? So somehow we got to do something about that. And it's actually quite crucial to the libertarian process that we have to have people with consciences and self-control and self-command. Because if you can't control yourself, somebody's going to have to jump in and control you. So we have to ask ourselves, well, where does conscience come from? Where does this even come from? And I discovered this personally. I know some of you have heard me talk about this subject before. How many of you have never heard me talk about the family before? Okay, so I'm going to tell an abbreviated version of my life story, basically. You ready? We're going to go fast here. Okay, so the short version is that I was a free market economist teaching at George Mason University. I had, I had taught at Yale. I had my doctorate, been to the University of Chicago. I had this great career ahead of me and so on. And so my plan for my family life was that, I was already married, because in those days you were supposed to be married before you had any kids. That's really old school, I know. But anyway, my plan was that I would, as soon as I got tenure at George Mason, I would have a baby at the beginning of the summer, and then take care of the baby during the summer, and then in September put the baby in daycare and go right back to work without ever missing a day of work. That was my plan for myself. And it's good to see y'all chuckling. It means you're alive and awake and adult. You know, I told that a couple weeks ago to some law students, and they all looked at me like, yeah, so what's wrong with that? You know, like, it's pretty funny. So anyway, well, imagine my surprise when the baby didn't arrive during the month that I had set aside for it. So my husband and I confronted a infertility crisis that lasted about 4.5 years, which for me was a whole crisis of faith, which brought me back to the practice of the Catholic faith, because it was the first time in my adult life that I couldn't get what I wanted by trying harder. Any sensible old wife will tell you, you're not going to get pregnant if you're trying hard. You know, that's just not how it works. But anyway, so we eventually resolved our infertility crisis by agreeing to adopt. We got a call in January of 1991 from a social worker telling us we have a little boy for you. We have a little boy who'll be 2.5 years old when you get him. He's coming from Romania. This is back in 1991. That was all just opening then. And, what do you say? And we said, sure, why not? And then 10 days later, I went to the doctor with a head cold and found out that I was pregnant. same story. My husband and I ended up having 2 children within 6 months' time, which is a record even for a Catholic. And, yeah, go ahead and gloat, you guys. Okay, all our separated brethren there. Yeah, okay. Yeah, that's how I knew I was back in the faith. But anyway, so we had these 2 kids who were 3 years apart in chronological age, but actually psychologically quite similar in age, because our little boy had been in one of those minimal care orphanages where the workers pick you up twice a day to change your diapers, whether you need it or not, you know, kind of thing. And so when we got him, he was unable to speak. He could not utter a single sound in any language. He wouldn't look at you. He didn't know his name. Think about that, a 2-year-old who doesn't respond to his own name. That's not normal development, right? And so we had to really get on the stick and do something to help this kid, because we didn't know. You know, my husband, you know, I was an economics professor, my husband an engineer. We were not prepared, okay, trust me. We were not prepared for what we were dealing with. But we were a pair of nerds, right, an econ person and an engineer person. We were a pair of nerds. And so naturally, what we saw when we looked at these two kids was a controlled experiment. And the experiment is, what difference does it make whether you have a mom and a dad in your life? You know, and the answer is, it's enormous. It's enormous. So in the process of trying to help our little boy, who is fine, by the way, so don't worry, when he's 25 years old and our daughter's 22, and you know, but anyway, in the process of trying to help him, we came to realize just how much mothers and fathers actually do. And the particular thing that I want to call attention to, because there's an enormous number of things. Yesterday, you saw me talking about rocking the babies, right? You saw me talking about that. If you haven't seen me talk about that, just realize that when you pick up the baby and start doing this kind of stuff with the baby, that's completely natural for you to do that. And the baby needs it. Everything you do that you think is natural is actually serving a particular developmental purpose. And we now kind of know enough scientifically to know what all that looks like. But who would have ever guessed? You would never figure it out, you know. But anyway, so in the normal course of child development, infant development, babies cry. That's normal. They cry because they need something. And normally somebody zips over and does something about it, right? And you pick up the baby and you start taking care of their needs. And then they relax and they go, oh, you know, mentally, they go, oh, I mean, not mentally, deeper than that, deeper than mental, because the mental isn't connected yet. The words aren't there, right? Somewhere in the tissues of the body, they're getting the picture that another person is the key to their survival, right? That mommy comes and it's all going to be good when mommy comes. And what do? You pick up the baby and you might nurse them, you might rock them, but you're almost always looking at them, aren't you? Aren't you? You spend a lot of time, you're going like this. When you're changing their diapers, you're going, doo, 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 and you're looking at them. You're always looking at them. Well, it turns out that when you're looking at the baby, you're helping their brain develop. There's a particular part of the brain called the limbic brain that governs your ability to be in relationship with other people. It's not developed until after you're born. It's developed right here in that kind of relationship. It's amazing when you think about it. But and the doctors discovered it when they went to Romania, when they went to Bulgaria, when they went to these Eastern European countries and just tried to do something about the kids in the orphanage. They saw whole rooms full of kids with a particular thing that they started to call institutional autism. Because all the kids had autistic-like symptoms that they've pretty much figured were induced by the orphanage experience. Okay? So autism, some people are in fact born with autism, but that doesn't, so I don't want anybody to be freaked out and think I'm blaming your mom if you've got an autistic kid brother or something, you know. But autism can be created through profound enough neglect. And so so that's one thing that can happen, is an inability to be social that becomes hardwired into the brain because the brain isn't developing properly. But what happens if nobody comes, the part where nobody comes, that attachment cycle that I described, that doesn't happen. You don't have the feeling that, okay, mom's coming to my rescue. It's all going to be good. I trust my mommy. And I'm going to do what mommy says. And I care whether mommy's happy with me. That's the foundation of the development of the conscience. And if nobody comes, what does the baby do? Nobody comes, the baby, first of all, they stop crying. Now think about that. A baby that doesn't cry, that's really pathological, right? Because they figured out nobody's going to come. So what they do is they kind of turn inward on themselves. And they stop looking. They stop looking for help. And they become interior like that. So when it comes time that you want to try to teach the child right from wrong, they don't have the attachment necessary that to where they care about what's right and wrong. And that condition is called the attachment disorder. Okay, the attachment disordered child does not care what anybody thinks of them. And so therefore they don't develop a conscience, and so therefore you got a problem. The family's got a problem, the society's got a problem. Normally when kids get in trouble, when they're really little, you know, you'll go pick them up and get them out of trouble, or you'll correct them, or you give them a little swat on the bottom, or whatever, right? But as they get older, you don't want to be doing that. You don't want to be running around. You know, when they're four, it's one thing. When they're 14, that's not going to fly, right? So what you're going to do as they get older is you start going like this to them. So you just give them that little mom look, you know, and then they go, oh, you know, they're sitting over there, oh. Or dad walks in. Dad walks, you know, everybody's, the whole tenor of the household changes because dad walks through the door. He doesn't even have to do anything, right? And dad, okay? So what is that doing? It means that the child is internalizing a sense of right and wrong. And you can be further and further away and have that right and wrong thing still programmed. That's what a conscience is. Is by the time you leave home, you're not worried about whether dad finds out. You are already the kind of person who doesn't even consider stealing the car because your next door neighbor left the keys in it. You're not even thinking like that, right? It's off the table. That's what a free society needs, is people who have a conscience. Without it, you can't have a free society, period, end of story. And so that's what the family does that nobody else can do. Trust me, the orphanages can't do it. Industrial care does not work for kids, right? Market care doesn't really work for kids. And for sure, government care isn't going to work for kids. There's no substitute for the family in getting this job done. Now, why is that? Since we're at the Acton Institute, we can talk about the human anthropology that is behind this reality. The fact is, the deep truth is that the human person is meant for love. The human person is meant for love. Now, we come from a variety of Christian traditions at the Acton Institute, but I'm pretty sure we all agree on that point. Right? Everybody agrees on that. It's something we know through divine revelation, and it's something completely mysterious to the economists and the philosophers. Right? They think in terms of rationality and all this other stuff. And they forget that the human person is meant for love. So John Paul II had a beautiful quotation from Redemptor Hominis that I like to share at this time. Man cannot live without love. He remains a being that is incomprehensible for himself. His life is senseless if love is not revealed to him, if he does not encounter love, if he does not experience it and make it his own. He could have been talking about the little head-banging children in the orphanage. He wasn't. He was talking about every person's encounter with Jesus Christ. That's what comes next, the encounter with Jesus Christ. We must encounter Christ or our life won't make sense to us. But it's literally true for these poor little kids in the orphanage, right? That their life doesn't make sense until they encounter love. And the first person they encounter love, a child should be their mother and their father. That's where the human person encounters love. And there's no substitute for that. There's no government program that's going to get out of that. We know in the Bible that it is not good for man to be alone. Well, science will go one better and tell you it's not even possible for man to be alone. Not even the left alone child will die. The left alone child will become demented. Right? If you treat a child like they're a hamster in a cage and put a little bottle in there and allow them to feed themselves whenever they feel like it, and some of those kids were treated like that, it's not going to work. And so what happens as a result of this is that in our culture, and this is what I wrote about in Love and Economics, in our culture, we believe that we are being more free if we have fewer obligations to children, if we can make and remake our family relationships according to adult desires and sensibilities. We think we're being more free. And in a certain way, that's true. But the next generation is going to be a whole lot less free if we go down that path. We think we're all being equal. Men and women are going to be equal if we do all these things that we've been talking about. But the next generation, there are going to be huge inequalities. And this is where we are now in our culture. Huge gaps of inequality are growing up in our culture around marriage. So that amongst the poor, marriage is less common, almost disappeared in some communities. And that widens the economic inequalities. So the inequalities that were there in the first place were just about money. Now they're about money plus family structure. And so even the economic inequalities are getting bigger and bigger as we go along. So rich people, college-educated people, by and large, get married and stay married, and they don't have kids until they get married. Well, they do have kids. They just abort them. I mean, you know, that's how you make it into the upper regions of your profession, is you get rid of the babies that are inconvenient. But anyway, that's so economically, their families looked like Leave It to Beaver in the 1950s. They just get started about 10 or 15 years later than Ward and June would have gotten started. But they're living very conventional lives. But in the meantime, they're tearing down the structures that allow other people to live conventional and comfortable lives. So marriage has disappeared among the lower classes and is making them more poor than ever. One of the big problems is, this is kind of an aside, a pro-life aside. One of the theories or one of the ideas about why we should allow abortion on demand is that babies aren't rational. And a human person only becomes a full-blown person with human dignity and human rights when they've become rational, when they're capable of rationality. Well, I just want to point out that what you're saying, basically, is you're putting the whole human race on probation until they get past this attachment period of time where they're able to speak, where they're able to be rational. The most important moral development is taking place when you're pre-rational, when you're pre-verbal. You're going to put the whole human race on probation? That is precisely the moment when you need absolute unconditional love from your mommy, is that period of time before you're rational. So if everybody goes on probation, is anybody ever going to develop the kind of conscience that you need? You know, hey, I've had it. I've had it with this kid today. You've pooped your diaper once too often. I'm calling child control. Get this kid out of here. I've had it. Okay, now why would I say that? Because these guys, these philosophers whose names I've put up here, are talking about what they call it after-birth abortion, post-birth abortion, that the family should be allowed to take out an infant because they're not yet rational. See, you can't go there. It is irrational to treat rationality as the ultimate criteria of personhood. It's irrational to do that. And of course, we have the authority of Margaret Sanger telling us that the most merciful thing a large family can do to one of its infant members is to kill it. So we're playing out the logic that stood behind the whole abortion on demand mentality. So the bottom line here is that the family doesn't do its job, nobody else can do it, and a free society is not going to long survive. So I've got in this PowerPoint a few references for further reading, which if you're interested in this brain development business, it can be found in this book and this report. And also Love and Economics, I deal with it. This is the book that I consider really the seminal work that I did, that's the foundation for all the other things that I've done. And that Love and Economics is for sale over there. Okay, so the last question that we want to take up in the last 7 to 10 minutes here is to talk about, how does the destruction of the family undermine the free market and minimum government? I've kind of hinted at it a little bit, but I want to spell it out for you now. And there are three things that I want to talk about. I want to talk about fiscal issues, I want to talk to you about privacy issues, and then I finally want to talk to you about a philosophical issue. So first, let's talk about the fiscal issues. All your libertarian friends will understand this. They all understand money. So first thing you want to talk about is the fact that the substitutes for the family are expensive and ineffective. And they're expensive to the taxpayer. So if you look at the cost of non-marital childbearing, what are you thinking about? What do we have to deal with? We have to deal with the fact that those kids don't perform as well in things like schooling, that the kids don't do as well in their mental health, that they end up in trouble with the criminal justice system. All these types of things are a substantial risk factor associated with children being raised in non-intact households. Okay, so these are all serious risk factors, including, of course, poverty itself. The government's involved in all of those things. The government's involved in poverty alleviation programs and school remediation programs and mental health programs. And, of course, criminal justice is the main business of the state, right? And so all of these things are expensive, to the taxpayer. Family breakdown is expensive to the taxpayer. Not to mention the fact that it's expensive to the family itself, the individual family. I'm not even counting those costs. So somebody did a study of this matter and calculated what are the costs of out-of-wedlock childbearing, and they came up with a figure of $112 billion per year of federal, state, and taxpayer dollars. And that is the equivalent of the GDP of New Zealand. So that's not small change here. That's not chump change. And it's usually the fastest growing year in and year out. These entitlement programs are among the fastest growing sector of the federal budget. So if you're interested in slowing down the growth of the state, you got to deal with this. You got to take it seriously, right? The second area that I want to talk to you about is I want to talk with you about the assault on privacy, the problem of lack of privacy, the assault on civil liberties that comes about as a result of the breakdown of the family. And in this area, there are some people who did this on purpose and who knew what they were doing, and there are some people who kind of stumbled into it. But what I'm talking about is the issue of unilateral divorce or no-fault divorce. Now, most people don't understand, and I know not everybody here is American, so let me just kind of explain what I mean when I use this term, unilateral divorce or no-fault divorce. It means that anyone can end the marriage for any reason or no reason, and you don't have to give a reason, right? That either party can put an end to the marriage. This is what I meant when I said earlier, the marriage is now a collection of individuals. Right, it's just there's no identity to the marriage itself. There's no sense that the government or anybody else has an obligation to protect the marriage. There's no bond. There's no defender of the bond like there would be in a tribunal in a Catholic canon law case. So one party can end the marriage unilaterally, and that means quite often there is a reluctant party, that one of the parties does not want the divorce. According to some estimates, As many as two-thirds of divorces are against the will of one of the parties. So this could be, a typical case would be, one party has a new sweetie, and they want to go live with their new sweetie. Now, under fault-based rules, that person would not be allowed to do that without paying some serious penalty, right? That person would be considered a faulting party, the other person would be considered the innocent spouse, and it would have to be proven that he was doing this. You would never volunteer to say, I'm going to go live with a new sweetie, you know, come get me, you know, kind of thing. It just, the whole character of the proceeding is completely different. So now, since there is a reluctant party, the government must create the separation. The government must enforce the divorce, which usually means separating somebody from the assets of the marriage. And the assets of the marriage are the house and the children. And so the government gets involved in allocating the child between the parents, allocating the financial assets of the two parties between the two parties. And so the government gets involved in the minutiae of family life, not just the financial stuff, which is obvious enough, but in regulating the relationships between the parties. Family courts get involved in regulating what school a kid's going to go to, what kind of religious practice they're going to have, whether you can go to your child's baseball game. If you show up at the baseball game, does that count against your family time? Are you stalking the child? And the wife can then have a restraining order put against you so that you can't go to a public event that anybody else would be allowed to go to. The state gets involved in the minutiae of family life, operating through the family courts. So it is an outrageous intrusion into the private sphere of the family, which is brought about by the state itself. It's brought about by the state's refusal to honor the reality of the marriage bond, and then having to get involved in dealing with the post-divorce conflict and so on. There are cases in divorce decrees, it will say, I get the child on Christmas Eve, and I must turn the child over to the other parent at 11 o'clock in the morning Christmas Day. And that'll be in a divorce decree, subject to enforcement by the family courts. When you think about it from the point of view of civil liberties, from the point of view of minimum government, it's an outrage. It's an outrage. There is no other area, there is no other agency of the state that we would allow into our homes on that basis, in such an intimate way. Not at all. And so why has this happened? How has this happened? It's happened because we have an institution called the family, which has its own integrity, which we have not understood and respected on its own terms. And so now the boundary between the public and the private is becoming completely obliterated through the actions of the family court. Now, this is not to say that there are no problems in the family. Of course, there are many problems in the family, and there are occasions where the state should be involved. But that we're way away from those cases. We are now in the realm of complete overreach into the family. So the final point that I want to make has to do with the basic philosophy of who we are. Again, it's Christian anthropology, and it has to do with this whole issue of third-party reproduction. It has to do with this indirectly. The question that is before us is, are we to see children as a choice that adults make, or are children a gift from God? And the Christian anthropology says that every human person is a gift from God. And the fact that we don't make a baby all by ourselves, that it happens randomly, is actually a beautiful thing. Because it means God's involved every time. Right? And every child is a gift from God. But when we say some children are a choice, isn't it wonderful that we wanted this child so much that we went to all this trouble to create this child, to make this child? Now what you've done is you've changed the playing field between the adults and the child. Because now the child becomes an object that is inferior to its maker. The mother and father have made that child, and the child is an object. Now they don't mean it. I'm not accusing them. They don't mean it. But that's the balance has shifted in some subtle ways, in some philosophic ways. And it's illustrated by this quotation that I have here, a philosophy professor talking about, do we owe the kids anything? Is the fact that the kids are upset about this sufficient reason for us to regulate artificial reproductive technology? Should we regulate it? Should we put some brakes on artificial reproductive technology? And what he's basically saying, this is kind of a convoluted lawyer speak, but basically what he's saying is that unless the child's life is so terrible that it's not a life worth living, that the adults do not have to take cognizance of any of the problems that they create through the method of conception. Adults have no responsibilities about that, because if it weren't for them, the child wouldn't exist at all. So as long as they have a life that's worth living at all, shut up. Sit down and shut up and take it. You take whatever we give you. That's basically what it comes to. So in other words, to paraphrase a notorious U.S. Supreme Court decision, an unborn person has no rights that a born person is bound to respect. I don't know if you know what Supreme Court case I'm paraphrasing there. Do you know? Dred Scott. Dred Scott, the word is a black person has no rights that a white man is bound to respect. Dred Scott said that. That's where we are now. The combination of Roe v. Wade plus artificial reproductive technology, we're talking ourselves into the position that unless the kids live a life of complete squalor, we didn't do anything wrong by bringing them into being under less than optimal conditions that we could have easily controlled, that we could have easily done something about, right? We've changed our concept of what is owed to children. So later this afternoon, I'm going to talk about how we got into this situation when we talk about the family and the state. But for now, I want to stop and take any questions that you may have about anything that I've covered so far. So thanks very much.
Listening to Dr. J speaking to Acton University participants on The Family and the Market. Stay tuned for her second talk. It's coming up in the next podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.